trying to help you, bro. I'm here for you.
Are we good? You have your breath back?
Man, I got bronchitis, too.
You're all making me run and stuff.
I'm trying to kill you, man. I'm trying to upgrade the show.
On to the NFL. The Eagles show Carson Wentz the love this offseason with a four-year extension, $107 million guaranteed. His head coach, Doug Peterson, said he sees this season as a great opportunity for Wentz, and he was highly complimentary of his quarterback. Wentz, by the way, coming off back-to-back seasons cut short by injury. See how hard it'll be for Wentz to return to his 2017 Pro Bowl form.
I don't think it's going to be hard. For one is, the experience that he got that year, even though it was ended with an injury late, is beneficial to the young player. Him bouncing back last season, having success, it's beneficial to him. Now with the personnel, this is the best offensive line. I believe it's the best running back combination that he has, fitting to the type of system that they want to play. And I believe top to bottom, their roster of top five wide receivers is better than the group that he had in that potential MVP season in 2017, led by, not by a number of catches and targets, DeSean Jackson, what he's going to do for Jeffrey, for Ertz at the tight end spot, for Aguilar, who is typically a slot receiver only. I believe every guy can play their role and play it specifically because D-Jack has so much speed. Last season, the only player in the NFL to average 18 yards a catch. And since he's come into the league, no one in the history of this great league has caught more touchdowns at over 60 yards than D-Jack. So I just think the personnel, his overall experience, lead to seeing the best Carson Wentz that we've seen, Nick.
So let's talk about the difference between 17 and 18, because his quarterback rating was identical. 102 in 2017 when everyone thought he was going to win MVP. 102 last year when people speculated was Nick Foles the better option. So how did he get there? In 2017, 33 touchdown passes compared to only 21 last year. That was the big difference. Same number of interceptions. The way he inflated his rating last year was he completed 70% of his passes. If he can get last year's completion percentage with 2 years ago touchdown rate, now you are talking about a league MVP level quarterback. The other big difference was in 2017 when they went 11-2 in his 13 starts, they jumped out on you. In the first quarter that year, he had 10 touchdowns, 2 picks, and a 120 rating. Was outstanding. Then Michael Bennett, those other guys could go hunt, go attack the quarterback. Last year, when they went 5-6 in his starts, only 3 first quarter touchdowns, a 78 rating. First quarter was his best quarter, then to his worst quarter. So now you're playing from behind. You're pressing a little bit more. All those things worked against him.
Also, it puts pressure on the head coach because he knows those numbers. He realized that, you know, last year, you know, not only was things a little bit different, but we didn't have Frank Wright. He had gone from being the offensive coordinator off to coach the Colts. And our offense began to suffer. So the pregame, that's how you get those big leads, the scouting report. So the coaching staff, I believe they've done a good job supporting him as far as talent. Now help him get off to that good start that he got used to in 17.
And in football, because the sample sizes are so small, like we look at, oh, Nick Foles won playoff games and back-to-back. He won Super Bowl and then won playoff game last year. Yeah, that the playoff game he won last year, I mean, there was a double doink involved. There was a field, like, so there's some good fortune there. Wentz, on the other hand, so I mentioned he's 5-6 in his starts. Could be, if he does nothing different.
Last year,
he can be 8-3. One game, Titans game, early in the year. They go to overtime, take the lead in overtime, and then the Titans score a touchdown with 5 seconds left in overtime to win that game. Panthers, they're up 17-0 going into the fourth quarter. Yep. The defense allows 3 straight touchdowns. You lose that game. The Cowboys game, wins his last start, goes to overtime. He never touches the ball.
Yeah.
Cowboys drive down the field, touchdown to Amari Cooper.
That was the deflection to Amari, right?
Absolutely right. So now all of a sudden, you've got 3 games that if you're 8-3 with Wentz, even with him getting injured, you feel one way. 5-6, then Foles does his thing, you feel a different way. But the injury is the real issue. This guy had stress fracture when he was growing up, broken wrist in college, blown up knee in the league, another stress fracture in his back last year. Like, multiple seasons of injuries. That's, to me, the biggest question about Wentz, much more than ability.
And as Bart Scott said earlier, a lot of that is because he was running off schedule. He was running off script. But he has his comfort blanket in Zach Ertz there now. He's got a guy like DeSean Jackson where he could feel comfortable going down the field. Mm-hmm. You're happy with his line. Doug Peterson said this is the best group of skill players on offense he's had since he's been there, since Carson Wentz has been there. Do you agree?
I believe that him and Howie Roseman, what they do from a front office, they're one of the top teams in the league. They do a great job of scouting, looking at what they need. They're always active as far as the trade market. So, yes, I think it's the most talented. I think that the wide receiver tight end combination, they have the type of versatility. I talk about when you're putting together a wide receiver group, it's got to be like a basketball team. You have to have different size, different skill sets, guys to be able to do different things. DeSean taking the top off the defense. Jeffries getting those first down. Ertz being their number one receiver and scoring in the red zone. Aguilar on third down. Can he come up with those critical catches? Can he get you yards after the catch? And I believe their fifth guy will be a guy that comes off the bench that fills in these spots. So, yes, I believe in what Doug's saying. Their offensive personnel, they don't have an excuse. And from the offensive line, Pro Football Focus has them ranked as the number one offensive line going into the season. Jason Peters, the veteran left tackle, they also drafted another tackle from Washington State in that first round that if he doesn't take over at tackle, you move him into guard, and you're talking about one of the best offensive lines getting a little bit better.
Well, I'm glad you bring up what they did in the draft this year because it's a really interesting kind of case study in a great front office and a front office in disarray. Because they jumped ahead of the Houston Texans to draft Andre Dillard. They knew the Texans wanted him. Mm-hmm. They knew the Texans were going to draft Andre Dillard to play tackle for them because they need two starting tackles. He was going to come in instantly day one, start for them. They've got a great young quarterback as well.
Yep.
Same draft class as Carson Wentz, I believe. Or maybe the year, yeah, same draft class as Carson Wentz. Yet they decide, no, we're not going to, we're going to wait in Houston. This guy's going to fall to us. And he doesn't. Philly, knowing they got a future Hall of Famer at left tackle, Lane Johnson, the highest paid right tackle in football, says, we're going to move up, get this guy. If he doesn't start a game for us at tackle this year, great. It means Jason Peters had a fully healthy season. If Jason Peters' age continues to get him, if he starts to deteriorate,
you got him.
We've got, you mentioned their wide receivers. They drafted in the second round J.J. Whiteside, a guy that they don't even think will have to play this year. The Eagles have done a brilliant job. They found Jordan Howard. I don't know why Chicago let him go, but they did. They signed him. A brilliant job manipulating the cap, finding value in the draft, and then buttressing their team, not just front line, but second line. All that to say this. Wentz has all the pieces in place.
Yeah.
Very good offensive line.
Yep.
Best receiver he's
had
in DJ.
Nobody looking over his shoulder.
All of it.
Yep.
And so this is a year for Carson to remind people who he was in 2017.
All right, let's switch gears, talk some basketball now. Houston Rockets. James Harden has already won an MVP. He's already made seven All-Star teams. And he's done it all before the age of 30. There is one glaring line missing on his resume, though. Yesterday, Harden says that he not only knows he needs to bring a championship to Houston, he promised he'd do it, quote, very, very soon. See, what do you make of what Harden had to say?
Well, there's a number of things that Nick and I agree on, that Houston is a better basketball team on paper. How it pans out, are they as effective playing the way they want to play? That we will see that during the regular season. But it's going to be difficult. And I think that it got more difficult because the top of the West is more top-heavy. I think that this team, with their ability to be able to shoot the three, spread the court, was a better match against Golden State. Now that Golden State's matched up, they have to rechange their focus because last 2 years, all we heard, owner, general manager, man, we're here to beat the Warriors. We are here to take down the Warriors. Where the Warriors are not there anymore. So how do they re-tinker their system to potentially mean, well, I might have to go through Denver. I might have to go through Utah. I might have to go through Portland. And then I might have to go through the Clippers. And I still might have to go through the Lakers. So that's, I believe they're capable of doing that. I don't believe that their coach is capable of adjusting. He's in the last year of his contract. They did not come to an agreement with the contract extension, which has been a problem. They made him make changes on the coaching staff this offseason. So, yeah, I like where Harden's career is. I like the fact that he got on the phone, talked to Russ, and he's excited about Russ coming there. Harden is a brilliant basketball player. I think that your stat, talking about what he's done the last 3 years.
Since D'Antoni's been there.
I mean, it's mind-boggling to believe. Are those numbers real?
Right.
32, 7, and 9 the last three seasons? So they're going to be players. They're going to have great careers. It's no indictment on them. Everyone can't win a championship. And I'm not just saying that because I didn't win a championship. It's just the reality. You can have a great career. It's fairly obvious, and not win the championship. And Harden, as stacked as the West is right now, and trying to promise it immediately, I just don't believe in team sports that you should make that type of guarantee. If he was playing golf, all right, if he was playing golf by himself, it's just him and the golf course, I can understand that. But you got other things that you have to depend on, and chemistry was one of the issues that they've struggled with him and Chris Paul. I do like what he said, I just believe it could have been carved a little different message as far as not to make it so individual.
If you wanted him to say, I think we are going to win a championship. I think this unit is going to deliver it, rather than him making it about what he is going to do.
Yeah, because I believe organizations win championship. I believe in organizational talent. I believe that their owner, even though he's new, he is trying to win. He's just not lip service like a lot of guys. Daryl, the general manager, got a lot of respect for him. I believe he's trying to win. I don't have as much faith as some people do in the coach, and I got the ultimate faith as far as a player who's developed, was a role player, now became a superstar in Harden.
I get why Harden's saying it, though, because he's got to, in quiet moments, think back on what he's done since he's been in Houston, what he's done since D'Antoni's been there, and thought to himself, man, what more can I do? D'Antoni's first year here, before Chris Paul got there, he said he wants me to play point guard. I lead the league in assists. I finished second in the MVP.
Something game. We didn't think that he could do.
Man, D'Antoni said, I think James Harden can average 12 assists a game. Everyone thought he was nuts. All he did was go out and average 11 and a half that year. The next year, they bring in Chris Paul. So now Harden has to adjust again. They win 65 games. He finally breaks through and wins the MVP, and they can't get past the Warriors. Last year, Chris Paul gets hurt. Other guys get hurt. Chris Paul gets suspended. James Harden has the best.
He saved their season.
Individual offensive season since Wilt Chamberlain. And then they get the Warriors. Durant gets hurt, and they can't get through. He's got to look back on these last 3 years and say, okay, 32-7-9, played 231 of a possible 246 games, no load management for him, playing 36.5 minutes per game. He's won two scoring titles, an assist title, first-team All-NBA every year, won an MVP, and finished second twice. And what's he got to show for? Nothing team-wise. Nothing, even not even a finals appearance. Only one conference finals appearance. Dame Lillard has been to the conference finals many times as Harden in this three-year stretch. You've got little Isaiah Thomas been to the conference finals as many times James Harden in this three-year stretch.
But as someone who had a resume like you did but didn't win a championship, does that lessen your place in the history of the sport? Does that take away from who James Harden is? Does that affect
his legacy? In the NBA, it does. In the NBA, go ahead, Chris.
In all sports, it's about winning. And if you're a great player, people just believe who cover the game. And I believe that it's justified that you can make the difference. A great player is like a combination of players. So I can understand that. But, you know, to me, that ain't no scarlet letter in my career. You played 16 seasons, you ain't win no championship. Yeah, but it wasn't because of me.
Well, but it's also in football, it's one thing. In baseball, it's one thing. In the NBA, it is a little different.
Yes.
Because people do feel like a great player can make the difference. In football, the only thing to compare it to really is a quarterback. And listen, Barkley is one of the 30 greatest players ever. He didn't win one.
He didn't win.
Ewing didn't win one. Stockton and Malone didn't win one. None of those guys ever had a three-year run like James Harden's just had. And all of those guys at least got to the finals as the best player on a team. Harden's never done it. Thinks he can do it this year.
We got to go. Have a great weekend, everyone. Take care. See you back here Monday morning.
Thanks, man. Go feel better.